Hi everyone, this is God's Girl G, and thank you so much for joining me today. For those of you who are new to my channel, welcome. And for those of you returning to my channel to watch this video and you're not already subscribed, I am going to encourage you to do so by clicking the subscribe icon below. And if during the course of this video you hear something that you like, I'm going to ask that you click the thumbs up, comment below, or better yet, share this video with someone who you feel could benefit from the information. With that said, let's get into today's discussion. Today's discussion is all about wrestling with doubt. But what's the difference between unbelief and doubt? Genuine unbelief is a complete rejection of faith or some part of it. Meanwhile, doubt is a state of questioning rather than a rejection. Doubt is indecision between belief and unbelief. When difficult circumstances come our way, it's not uncommon to ask, why me, why now, and why this, Lord? Sometimes God answers those questions. However, more often than not, God does not give us specifics. He simply asks that we trust him. Now, we usually associate doubt with the infamous Doubting Thomas. But at first, all the apostles doubted reports of Christ's resurrection. So I don't want to use a familiar story for this. Instead, I want to talk about John the Baptist. Yes, John. Now, John was a godly man, raised in a godly home. His parents served God, and his mother, Elizabeth, knew that Jesus was Lord, even while Mary was pregnant with Jesus. Surely John grew up with this information, and Jesus' status as Messiah was confirmed to him when he saw God's Spirit descend on Jesus at the point of his baptism. Now, if anyone should have been sure of Jesus' identity, it was John the Baptist. But the New Testament reveals a moment of dramatic doubt in John's life. He was languishing in prison and began to wonder, if Jesus is truly the Messiah, why am I his messenger here in prison? So he sent his disciples to ask Jesus, are you the expected one, or do we look for another? Jesus replied to them, go and report to John what you have seen and heard. The blind receive sight, the lame walk, the lepers are cleansed, the deaf hear, the dead are raised up, and the poor have the gospel preached to them. Then he gently rebuked John's doubting by adding, and blessed is he who keeps from stumbling over me. Don't you just love Jesus's response? He always knew exactly what to say. Jesus went on to tell the crowd that among those born of women, there is no one greater than John. He was a godly man, but he had his time of doubt. Jesus knew John, loved John, and understood the trial that John was enduring. Doubt is displayed by everyone at some point in their life. If John the Baptist experienced doubt, we will probably find ourselves in similar situations. I know many wise and confident Christians, and in spite of their confidence and strength, they've all experienced moments of doubt at one point or another. It's not a sign of our weakness. It's a sign of our humanity. You and I should expect to have doubts at some point in our lives. When those times of doubt arise, it's important for us to return to the evidence that brought us here in the first place. That's what Jesus did for John. He provided clear evidence that helped John connect the dots, so to speak, and reminded John of Jesus's identity. Given all the other things that Jesus could have done or said, it's remarkable that even Jesus used evidence to deal with John's doubt. Now, there are three different types of doubt that I want to talk about. First, there's the doubt of the proud skeptic. That's the one who delights in their own intellect. They'll pit themselves against God as if they're a match for the Almighty. But Psalms 14 and 1 says, the fool has said in their heart, there is no God. Second, there's the person who wants to believe, but struggles with difficult questions, and they have not yet come to see Jesus Christ as the all-sufficient Savior of sinners. I'm reminded of a scripture, John 7 and 17, where Jesus says, if any man is willing to do his will, he shall know of the teaching, whether it is of God or whether I speak from myself. Third, there's the believer who has gotten their eyes off of God in the midst of a very difficult situation. All of us who believe in Jesus Christ as Savior have been there too. We believe, but we get our eyes off the Lord and onto the trial that looms before us. If you let a trial consume your vision, it will block the glorious power of the Almighty God. I've said before, we can't be consumed by our problems and with God at the same time. During these moments of doubt, I'm reminded of a very important scripture that I'd like to share with you. If any of you lack wisdom, let him ask God, who gives generously to all without reproach, and it will be given him. But let him ask in faith, without doubting. For the one who doubts is like a wave of the sea that is driven and tossed by the wind. That was James, the first chapter, verses 5-6. I want to give you 4 faith keys for overcoming doubt. Faith key 1, stop overthinking. If you're the type who is constantly ready to jump to the negative or run the what-if scenarios, you will think your way right out of faith. God's promises rarely make full sense with our finite mind. Never does he require us to use our reasoning to trust him. His word is truth. So line up your thinking with his word, and you'll be back in the faith game in no time. Faith key number 2, recall what he's done before. Remember, God will always do what he says he's going to do. Get your eyes off of your current situation and remember his resume in your life. All of the things that he's delivered and done for you. Has God delivered you from a sticky situation? Have your bills been paid when there seemed to be no way? God didn't save you just to drop you. If he's not doing what you're praying for, he might be trying to do something in you first. Hang on to what he's done in the past. And remind yourself that if he did it before, he will surely do it again. Faith key number 3, block the negativity. Doubt is often connected with disappointments or long-term trials. It's hard to stay in faith when there's constant negativity around you. Even Jesus banished the crowd when he healed the ruler's daughter because of their lack of faith. If you're constantly letting negativity in, you will never overcome doubt. But if you allow the word of God to build up your faith, doubt and unbelief will be crowded out. Faith key number 4, only believe. Yes, belief is a choice. Just because you're feeling doubtful does not mean that you need to stay there. In every situation, you will have a choice. Believe or not believe. It's easier to choose belief when you stop looking at your circumstances and you keep your eyes on him. If you let it, unbelief can be a faith killer. If you want to live a life of faith, you have to be desperate enough to push through those moments of doubt. And don't forget, pray. Always, always, always pray as though your faith depends on it. Ask God, who gives liberally, and he will give you the wisdom that you need in the moment that you need it. Not before, not after, but right on time. Also remember to stay in scripture. Faith comes from hearing, and hearing from the word of God. It is important that you get into the word of God daily. Let God speak through his word and encourage you. Thankfully, God in his grace often pours out his blessings in spite of our doubts. We can overcome the problem of our doubt if we see that God will do what he says he will do. God does want to bless you. He does want to deliver you, to deal with your doubt. Make sure your heart is in submission to God. God will always aid you when you seek Him. Lord, I believe. Help my unbelief. Thank you for joining me today. And don't forget to subscribe, like, comment, and share. Bye.